So I hope you had a good poster session yesterday. Unfortunately, we could not come and see what you were producing, but I hope you had the possibility to exchange and to see what others are doing. It's always interesting. It's stimulating to see the work of others. So there are a few topics first to just to, I thought it would be useful to describe. One of them is how one measures the rate of damping. And when you have a simple system, for example, like this Helmholtz resonator of yesterday, and you want to know what is the damping, one very simple method is as follows. You put a loudspeaker here, you take a microphone, M0, this serves as a reference. And then you put a microphone at the bottom of this device, and you drive the speaker at a given frequency, and you see what happens at the microphone M1, and M0, this serves as a reference, and you take the root mean square of the pressure at M1, divide that by the root mean square of the pressure at M0, and plot the response curve as a function of frequency. What you learn in textbooks, what you've done probably in vibrations, or so this is typically what you can do here. And you know that if you take the position at half height and you measure the bandwidth here, you see this delta F here, you can determine what is called the quality factor. So the quality factor Q is equal to F divided by delta F, F0. So you see, if your resonance is very sharp, this quality factor will be very high. For example, if F0 is 100 times delta F, this quality factor is very high. On the other hand, if you have something which is highly damped and the resonance will be just like that, you see that the quality factor will be low. And we know that the dissipation rate can be obtained from this delta F according to this expression. You just multiply delta F by pi and you have an expression for the damping. So we've used that a number of times to get an idea of the damping. So just by looking at this bandwidth at half maximum, you can definitely already say, oh, this is very highly damped, or on the other hand, it's weakly damped. The limit is, of course, to have something like that. This would be just extremely resonant and nothing else elsewhere, but you don't get that. So the second point was raised by a lady this morning. She was asking what happens when you change the fuel and the oxidizer, or when you change the mixture. How do you account for that? Have you seen that? So what I was saying is, for example, yesterday we looked at the transfer function of the conical flame. And perhaps you've seen, noticed that the variable that comes into the picture in that case, of course you can plot the transfer function with respect to frequency, but it's better to use something which is dimensionless. This is typically a dimensionless quantity. It's omega times the diameter of the burner. You see, this is your burner here. You have the conical flame. SL is the burning velocity. And alpha zero is this half angle of the flame, and you can show analytically that this is the right quantity. So you can plot this in terms of this quantity, and then all the curves collapse. In fact, when you do a dimensional analysis, you can say what are the variables that are influential for the transfer function. So what are these variables? Of course, the frequency. The frequency, or you can use here omega, as you want. Certainly, the velocity of the flow is important. Certainly, SL. SL itself depends on the mixture. And so you include in SL already a lot of the physics of this flame. And the diameter. You definitely see that. So now the diameter, sometimes you can say, oh, the length of the flame might be important, but the length is somewhat proportional to the diameter. So basically, these are the independent variables. So how many variables? We have n is equal to 4. And these variables, this is time minus 1, Lt minus 1, Lt minus 1, and L. So we have two fundamental units. K is equal to 2. So we know that there are two dimensionless parameters. And what are these dimensionless parameters? F, you can write F as a function of something like Fd over. So it's up to you. What sort of velocity do you put here? For example, you can put u here. And the second quantity is SL over u. So these are the two groups. And so using just dimensional analysis, you see that these are the two quantities that will appear. It turns out that for the conical flame, you can actually merge these two quantities. SL over U is close to you describe that in terms of this cosine alpha zero, so you don't have, in fact, these two things. But it's always it's always useful to use dimensional analysis and try to see what are the parameters. You can think, yeah, maybe there are other important parameters here, for example, the Lewis number or something else. So that may be true. I'm not sure. I don't know what happens when you take, for example, hydrogen air. We didn't do these experiments. This was planned, but we had so much to do that we didn't do it. So I don't know what goes on when you change in a strong way the composition of the mixture. Okay. Do you have any questions on that? This was just a few remarks to begin with. So let me do again this second problem where we study instability, and this is the instability, the self-sustained instability of V flames. We've seen this V flame. We noticed that it was responding to modulations. In this case here, what we want to do is exactly what we did yesterday for the M flame. For the flame interacting with a plate. Here we are going to do that for this V flame. So again, we study in many cases flames which are confined. We study also situations where the flames are confined but not too confined, and in some cases they are unconfined, like in radiant burners. And this actually pushed us to study some of these instabilities because there were problems in the paper industry in using such radiant burners. They would become very unstable, and so we studied these configurations. In many circumstances, you have flames which have a V shape. For example, when you have a swelling system, the flame looks like a V, more or less. Here it's not quite that, but this is a typical experimental flame in a swirling flow, and you see the flame has this V shape. So it's interesting to look at V flame. And then here, This is a simple device. So you see now there is no more loudspeaker here. It's just a rod. The flame is sitting here. And for certain conditions, this system by itself becomes unstable. It's, there are bands of instability. So even such a simple system has instability. What is resonating? Well, it's this Helmholtz resonator. This looks like a bottle. And you know that a bottle has resonances. And so, for example, we find that at this frequency of 172 hertz, at this equivalence ratio and so on, you have these oscillations which appear. So this can be watched by a photomultiplier with a filter. We put a microphone here. We can have that on a camera. And the process is that velocity fluctuations coming in out from this nozzle produce heat release fluctuations. These heat release fluctuations produce pressure fluctuations, and the pressure fluctuations produce velocity fluctuations. So we have a loop here, and this is what we would like to put into equations, because this is qualitative, but we want to write that into equations. And so of course we can study the transfer function of this flame, and this was done by putting a loudspeaker here and looking at that transfer function. And this is what is obtained. The gain is like that. So you see it's like a low pass filter, not quite, because it has a maximum here, and then it decreases. And beyond that frequency, you see the gain is very low. So even if you put acoustic waves in this system at these high frequencies, you cannot expect to have a strong response. The phase here is linear, and so more or less linear. It's not quite, but it's reasonably linear. And so you expect to have here a delay, a time delay, a time lag. And so and you can determine this time lag just by taking the phase and dividing. You see, you take the phase and divide by the frequency, and you get the time lag. You use the expression that the phase is omega tau. So phase is like omega tau. So delta phi is like omega delta omega times tau. And so tau is obtained simply by taking the slope of delta phi divided by delta omega. So now delta omega itself is 2 pi delta f. So delta phi divided by 2 pi delta f. So in fact, if you plot this and you go at 2 pi here, you see that it's about 140 hertz. And then this is 2 pi, so you have 2 pi. So it's 1 divided by 140. It makes 8.6 milliseconds. So here you get immediately an idea of the delay. And what is this delay formed by? Well, it's, as I told you, vortices are formed at the nozzle exhaust, and then they impinge on the flame, they roll up the flame, and you see the flame sheet takes this shape, and it's nice to watch dynamically. So you see this is at a low frequency, this is forced, this case are forced. So you see that these vortices which are shed here roll up the flame, and then the flame is burns all the material here and makes a pulse. And so these vortices, the interaction between the vortices and the flame is important here. And we have another case here which is closer to the frequency of the self-sustained oscillations. And you see now there are many vortices produced, but the time during a given period, there are, let's say, three vortices which are here, and they interact with the flame here. So this is what produces the heat release fluctuations. So the delay in this case is due to these vortices shed and interacting at a later time with the flame. And so and we can also watch that by making Abel transform of the flame and looking at the vorticity as it is shed. And you see you have this vorticity here, this velocity profile. Now I told you you can look at the resonance of this system, and the resonance has this shape, and you see that by looking at the bandwidth here, you can say something about the damping. We know also that this frequency, the resonance frequency, has this expression. S1 is the area of this channel of the nozzle. C-square is the sound speed inside this Helmholtz resonator. And V is the volume, this volume here. And L, which comes in here, is a measures the size of this channel, the length of the channel, but you see, to accommodate the fact that you have a change in area, you have to do that. And this gives you an effective length. It's not exactly the length, because you see the area decreases here. Here you have a nozzle. It's not just a volume and a channel, it's a volume and a contoured section, and finally you get to the exhaust here through a channel. So you can use that, and you get a resonance frequency around 163 hertz for the given dimensions here. So yesterday I derived this expression, which gives you the velocity fluctuations. It's a second order system, which represents the Helmholtz resonator. Now, Helmholtz resonators are used for damping. They are often used in industrial systems to damp a given oscillation. So you shape the resonator so that its frequency is the same as the frequency of what you want to damp, and you use the damping in your resonator to obtain the damping, to increase the damping of your system. This is used quite extensively in practical systems. So here we are interested in the resonances driven by the pressure fluctuations which occur at the exhaust of this resonator. So you have a mass here. Actually, it's the mass of gases inside the channel. You have a damping, and damping here is in fact related to the flow velocity inside this system. It's a Helmholtz resonator with some flow, so it's not quite what you find in most cases. And then you have a stiffness which has this shape, rho c square s1 square divided by v. So it looks like a second order system, a spring, a mass, and a damper. You've certainly learned that in your early years of university years, or even in high school. So the resonator, now what is new is that the resonator is driven by this pressure fluctuation. So we want to relate the pressure fluctuations to the heat release. And what is found here is a little strange, but this is how it is. It is found that the pressure at time t at the microphone looks very much like the intensity that is detected by the photomultiplier. One would expect something like that, but in fact it's more like that. It's why? Because this system is open, and air is coming in also, in this case. So it's not quite under conditions where the equivalence ratio is constant. So perhaps this is the reason. So anyway, we observe that this signal and that signal look alike. And it's not the derivative. It's just some proportionality. And there is also a shift. You see, the two are shifted. And now, so what we are going to do is to say first, the intensity fluctuation is driven by the velocity fluctuations right here with a certain delay. And then the pressure, which is returned by this process of interaction, is proportional to the intensity fluctuations here. And so we have directly a relation between the pressure and the velocity at this injector. So by doing this, you get this equation for the resonator, and it's driven by the differential of the pressure. Then you have the pressure, which is proportional to a delayed version of this heat release, of these fluctuations in intensity or heat release. And these are directly proportional to the velocity delayed by this convective time. Omega zero here is just that expression. We've seen that. It is nice to represent this as follows. And omega is some kind of, it's a term which will appear because when we plug that and that into this, we will get this expression. So finally, this is the master equation which describes these oscillations. And you see that it's a second order system. And on the right-hand side, we have something which is proportional to the velocity, but it is delayed. And you can suspect that by placing that into this side, there are certain values of this delay. Now, tau A is very small. It's just the time it takes for acoustic, the travel time, the acoustic travel time. While tau C is more sizable, it depends on the convection of the vorticity towards the flame. So basically, tau is equal to tau C. And you can show by looking at that equation that when omega zero tau belongs to this interval modulo 2 pi, you have instability regions. It's you have to actually look at that equation and work out the effect of delay. So when you do that, you take the transfer function and you plot on the transfer function these bands of instability. And then you plot on this plot, you find the resonance of the Helmholtz system, the resonator, and you see that at the frequency of resonance, you are in an unstable band. It's not the first band. In fact, it's the second band because you are here. And also at that value, the gain is reasonable. You have a reasonable gain, so you can expect instability here. So like that, you have an explanation for your instability based on the measurements, based on this little model. You have something which allows you to understand this why this flame becomes unstable and radiates sound. All right, these are the conclusions. You have a few other slides here, but let's stop that. Do you have any questions on these? The length, the effective length, it's the fact that you... No.
I asked what means delta?
Delta. Small delta is a damping parameter. We are used to write to write. Sometimes you call it delta, sometimes we call it zeta. We write second order systems in this form. This is a nice standard form. So, for example, if you have nothing driving it, it's like that. So omega zero is the fundamental frequency, the angular frequency, and delta is the damping. It's nicer to write that in this way because the solution here, V prime, is like, how does it look like? E to the minus delta, omega zero t, and then you have something like cosine omega zero t, or sine and cosine, or something like that. So you see delta is a dimensionless damping, and this sets the value of the damping, delta omega zero sets. So it's just a notation. Sometimes instead of delta, we put here zeta. So you have to be, in this case, zeta is also dimensionless. Sometimes, yeah.
So compared with the main curve on the plate,
yes.
The two systems seem to be sized with the same method. But in yesterday case, the plane is perturbed by an external loudspeaker.
No. No. Yesterday, we also studied, yes, the question is, compared to yesterday where we studied the flame interacting with the plate, in the two cases, these two last cases are self-sustained. You just put a plate, you have your burner with its resonance, and you just watch the self-sustained instabilities. For certain distances of the plate, the system is unstable. It oscillates, it produces sound. And we explained that again with this Helmholtz resonator equations, and we related the pressure, the heat release, and the velocity at the resonator, and that gave us a model. So it's this was the first problem that we did was on the plate. So it was just, we had a plate here, and the flame was here, interacting with the plate. And by changing the distance between the plate and this, we could watch regions of stability and regions of instability. But at the bottom here, there was no loudspeaker. The loudspeaker is there only to determine the transfer function. For example, here we determine the transfer function, but afterwards we take the loudspeaker out. Yeah. So it's a system. It's there. Yeah. You can and suddenly you see that the system, even for these unconfined flames, the system becomes unstable by its own. Its own field feeds oscillations, and you have this growth of oscillations. The damping is not enough, and you have oscillations. All right, so let's now move to another topic. So you see, up to now we have not studied the non-linearities in the systems. However, they are very present. In many cases, what is being studied is just the growth of instability like that. This is the linear growth, the initial part of the growth. But in many circumstances, what you see is directly a limit cycle. The limit cycle is an oscillation. It's an established oscillation that is there. And most of the experiments just give you the limit cycle, not this initial growth. So basically, what we would like to do is to extend what we are doing to get, for example, the amplitude of the limit cycle. What is the pressure fluctuation that you get here? And so the idea is as follows. This is a linear concept. The flame is just described in terms of the frequency, and its response is given with respect to some sort of perturbation upstream. But the flame responds in a nonlinear fashion. Combustion is highly nonlinear. So how does one modify that to become nonlinear? One idea is the following, is to consider that the level of the input will change the transfer function. So you will have a transfer function for each level. A small level, you have a transfer function. Another one, you have a... So it's like a family of transfer functions corresponding to the input level here. This is the level of the input. And this is called, this has a name in control theory, it's called the describing function. The simplest way to accommodate nonlinear systems in controls is to use this concept, the describing function concept. Who has been exposed to this among you? Have you taken courses in controls? It's not, yes, you have, some of you. So did you hear about describing function methods? Not so much. Nevertheless, they are very useful. It's a rather simple idea. It's just to say, I'm going to characterize the system by a transfer function which will depend on the input amplitude. It's somewhat paradoxical because the transfer function is a linear concept, and in principle, what you put at the input is exactly translated by a multiplying factor at the output. So this is the idea. And it's quite widely used in controls. So that's something. It has also been used in combustion. For example, Anne Dowling wrote a paper on a kinematic model where the kinematics of the flame was limited, was saturating, and as a consequence, she used a describing function. It's a model, it's just a theoretical model there. And during that period, we started thinking that this was a useful concept, and we wrote this paper. And I think this has really triggered a lot of work now in this direction. The idea, you will see that it's very helpful. It provides a way to actually calculate limit cycles and also describe a lot of the nonlinear phenomena that are seen in practice. And a number of other papers have come out on using this concept. So you see, again, this is a transfer function, and the describing function is just to consider that the transfer function depends on the amplitude of the input. And as you see, you can determine limit cycles and nonlinear features like mode switching. Mode switching is like that. You have a system, it operates, and suddenly, at a given time, it goes to a different frequency. Why? So that's very standard. Another one is triggering. Triggering is the fact that you have a system which is stable, and suddenly, due to a perturbation, bang, it becomes unstable, and you have oscillation. This is typical of the behavior of rocket engines. The test, rocket engines are tested for instability by putting small bombs, an explosive, exploding the bomb and seeing if the oscillation will come out or not. So it's a bomb test. So now, and the phenomenon that one wants to see is triggering. Is the system able to sustain a perturbation and come back to stable, or is it going to become unstable? So, using this FDF, it is possible actually to describe that and to describe also hysteresis. Hysteresis is the fact that when you do something to a parameter on going this way, and when you do it that way, what you get is different. So this happens again in combustion, and we are going to show that as well. So what we will do here is to try to include this nonlinear dynamics using the flame describing function concepts. And we were working on this, the problem of having a perforated plate producing little flames like that, and we place this plate at the end of a resonating duct. So you see the duct here, and there is a piston in the duct, and in fact we inject the mixture through small holes in this piston. So you can see a view of the perforated plate here. The equivalence ratio is given here. We burn air and methane. And this will be the resonant manifold. And here is just the flame. So in this case, it was intended to study oscillations of these radiant burners. This gives a detailed view of the flames as they are actually operating, and you see that pockets are formed and then they are shed from the flames and produce a pulse of pressure. And so this is a nice system because by changing the lengths of the system, you can scan the different resonances. And here you see the system operating in a stable mode. Unfortunately, the sound doesn't work, but I'll put it again here. So, So in this case, you have a stable region, not very large. In fact, this system is pretty unstable for essentially all the sizes of the tube. So you change the piston position and it's unstable, and by changing that position, you change the frequency of resonance. You can look at the various modes of oscillation of this system. All right, so this is how it operates in the unstable case. So you see that all these flames execute the same motion, and you have these bubbles which are produced and which burn at a later point and of course send an acoustic wave. And in this case, for example, the frequency is 530 hertz. The level of sound is pretty large at the distance. You see, if you put your ear at that distance, it's pretty loud. So you need earplugs and you need headsets to protect your ears. This is how it looks under operation. So all these flames act like soldiers on a parade, you know. And so the idea is to look at the at the pressure, heat release, and flow velocity, and we are interested in the limit cycle. You see, the limit cycle is here. In this case, we were able actually to see how the pressure was growing. By lighting, we ignited, and at first there was very little pressure or very little heat release fluctuation, but afterwards it's rather large. You see the mean is here, and the fluctuation is here, so it's pretty large. A gentleman, a big scientist who worked on limit cycles, there is in fact a theorem about limit cycles by Poincaré and Bendixson. When you walk in the building through this door and you look at the various books, there is a book, a biography of Henri Poincaré. Yeah, he was a very famous mathematician. He did a lot on nonlinear systems, on secular problems, vibrations, vorticity as well. He worked also on relativity. It turns out that the house of Henri Poincaré, or one of his houses, is 200 meters from my house. It's in the same neighborhood, and he lived somewhere there. It's in the south of Paris. And so Henri Poincaré was a very famous scientist. We had also a president of the French Republic, Raymond Poincaré. Nothing, in the same family, but not the same level of science. This guy was. So anyway, the limit cycles are very, very important. That's.
The holes, why are they from the sides instead of from the top? Those holes.
The holes, yes. You see, the holes are. In the piston. We wanted to have a system where we could inject premixed gases, and if you put them on the duct itself, when the piston is above that, it doesn't work. So we decided to inject through the piston itself, that's all. To have premixed gases, fresh gases, all the time in the system. So the one idea was to actually use the piston to inject. Yes.
On the pressure traces on the next slide.
Yes.
In particular, the first one. What's the significance of the fact that it's not very symmetrical?
Yes, you're right. It's funny. We don't have something symmetrical. Probably it's nonlinear already. It's already. You would expect something more, something like exponential, but. Here it's rather exponential, but on that side it's not. And and the heat release is also like that. You see, and here the flow velocity are also somewhat ragged. So this is reality versus theory. Theory is always clean and exponential, and in this case, you know, the limit cycles can take many. Possibilities. Sometimes you have galloping limit cycles, sometimes you have patches, and this is what you get in practice. In fact, combustion instability can be whoa, like that, or do all sorts of noises. In fact, there is a wide variety of noises to describe these instabilities. It's screech and chugging and whatever, especially in the rocket industry. Yes.
Following up on what the gentleman said over there.
Yes.
Instead of injecting through the piston, why couldn't you have injected through the walls?
Very close to the perforated plate, it would have been the flow might not have been very nice there. Yeah, so everything is filled with premixed gases. It's rather clean. It was a good idea to do that. It's you can try something different. But this one was enough to provide a very large set of experiments, because then you can change the parameter. The geometry can be changed at your own wish. And so you can scan all the modes in an easy fashion. And you can change the equivalence ratio as well. But already you have this very nice parameter, which is just the dimension of the system. All right. So what happens here? Yeah. So what is the mechanism here? Again, you have fluctuations of velocity producing heat release fluctuations. These heat release fluctuations produce pressure fluctuations, and these pressure fluctuations act on this boundary here and produce a mode inside the cavity, and this mode can be resonating, corresponding to this dimension of the system. And when you measure the transfer function, you see that as you increase the level of the input, so how do you measure the transfer function? You need another device where you put a loudspeaker, you have the perforated plate, and you do that. So you have devices where you do these transfer function measurements, and then you have this device which has self-sustained instabilities. So this is the gain, and this is the phase, and you see that in this case here, the gain itself and the phase, both of them actually change with the amplitude. So this is a beautiful example of the fact that the transfer function changes with the amplitude. And so we are going to use this. It's a simple idea to actually extend the linear concepts into the nonlinear world. So you see now the gain depends on the amplitude here, and the phase depends on the amplitude. And if you plot that in three dimensions, it's nicer. You can see that the gain is here at low levels, and as you increase the level, you are like that. And the phase is also a surface. It's not a flat plane. It is a surface. Of course, you don't have all the points. So beyond a certain value, you don't have the capacity either to put a very strong input or after those points, you have to do some extrapolation and there is a little difficulty, but well, numerically you might be able to go to these points, but experimentally you are limited by your actuators and anyway, this is the describing function. And now what we learned is that if we look at the pressure, for example, and it's always P times exponential of minus I omega t, we assume that we have this harmonic behavior, and omega, you see the pressure is something like P omega e to the minus I omega t. And omega itself is a real part and an imaginary part. And if we plug that in this, it gives exponential of minus I omega r t plus omega I t. So if omega I is positive, it's unstable. And if it is negative, it's stable. So now the I went too fast. So now what we've done already, for example, in the simple example a few days ago, H of omega was the dispersion relation, and we looked at the roots of that relation. And we found the places where omega I was unstable, and that gave us an idea of the condition for instability. And here, what we have now is that H will depend on U prime, because H involves the describing function, and this depends on the level of the input. As a consequence, omega R and omega I are also functions of this U prime, or U prime over U bar, so that when you calculate this these roots of this dispersion relation, then you will have a trajectory as a function of this U prime. So for example, you have type 1 trajectories. You start here. Here you have omega I. This is the imaginary part of the angular frequency. And this corresponds to these values here. This is given in radians, seconds minus 1. And then you have the frequency here, which also changes as a function of U prime. So what you see is that initially, for example, in this case, you have a positive value of omega I, rather large. And as you go in amplitude, suddenly you get to a zero. So this is the place where you will have the limit cycle, because from there on, omega I becomes negative. In fact, you have to take into account damping. So in fact, the point of the limit cycle will be like that here. And you see that the frequency also changes. It begins here, and then it changes to that point. So when you have the limit cycle, it will be here. This is another case where you plot here the frequency on one side, and you plot here the imaginary part of omega I, and you see that you start from this point, and which is very close to the three-quarter wave mode, and then you move to the limit cycle, which is here. So the frequency has changed by perhaps 30 hertz, and the growth rate has changed here. And the limit cycle, in this case, we assume that there is no damping, so omega I is zero. There is a little bit of damping. And so in this case, this is the three-quarter wave obtained for this size of the duct. It's what we call mode 2. And you can do this exercise of calculating omega I as a function of U prime. Of course, you know you have to determine this dispersion relation, but this can be done. It's again, it's a problem like all the others. You can write down. It's in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics paper. You can write down the dispersion relation, but now it depends on U prime. And when you do this exercise, you find also trajectories like that. Some cases where at very low values of U prime, you have negative omega I, and suddenly you get to a point where you are beyond zero, so it becomes positive, and then it becomes again zero here and negative. So what you expect here is that for this condition, there is no, the system is stable, but if you perturb the system, it can become unstable and reach this limit cycle here. And you see the frequency also changes during this process. You don't stay at the same frequency, you change the frequency. For example, for this case, you have 20 centimeters, it's the quarter wave mode, and this mode is not unstable by itself. That is, you don't observe that if you are sufficiently careful. But by perturbing the system, you can get to this point here. And what happens to the frequency? You see the frequency comes from here and moves to that point here. So you change the frequency during the limit cycle development. And so we've done that exercise for the whole parametric range that we could change the lengths here, and we calculated the growth rates. These are contour plots of the growth rates. This is for the quarter wave mode. You see that for the same condition here, you have also a three-quarter wave. Then you have the three-quarter wave mode here, and the five-quarter wave mode here. And for example, if you take a slice here, you see that the three-quarter wave mode is unstable, and you get to a limit cycle here. And then you can stay there, but if you have a perturbation, you can jump down to here. I mean up to here. If you are here, you see that the system is linearly unstable. You are here, you go to an even higher value of the growth rate, and then it diminishes to this point, and you get somewhere here. In this case, if you start here, you have the five-quarter wave, and then at a point, you see this growth rate is larger than this one, and so you expect switching to occur from this point on, and you get finally to the three-quarter wave. So in this case, initially, it begins with a five-quarter wave, but then it reaches this point here where switching takes place, and it goes to the three-quarter wave. And this was done numerically. All of this is, you take the dispersion relation, you know the transfer, the describing function, you calculate the roots, you do that for all the values of U prime, and you get this plot, and then you want to compare that with experiments. So this is much less available in the literature. This case was, we've done this comparison, and what I can say is it's quite remarkable. It's not perfect, but it's you get a very nice description of what you find in practice. So for example, you model the fact that the frequency is changing and goes to the limit cycle here. And this is indeed what you observe. You see here, there is a, you do not see that the frequency changes, but it does very little. And in fact, you can follow the frequency here. And you can see that the frequency actually changes from initially it's higher, and then it gets to something like 500 here. And when you plot the position in terms of frequency, it does follow what you predict. So suitable estimation of the limit cycle amplitude and of the frequency shift during the growth of oscillation. Second, when you scan the system in this direction, what you find is initially, so the piston is very close to the plate. And here you find the frequencies right here. And you get initially the quarter wave mode, which is here. So the experiments are here. And this is what is calculated here. So you see it's nice. You do not see the other mode because this one is dominant. And then you fall, this region here is stable. And indeed, you have a stability here. And then you increase the level, the size of L. And again, the positions, the experimental positions are here. And you follow the levels that are calculated. Not quite, you see there are differences here. And then you arrive in this region here. And the experiment tells you that it's the five-quarter wave which appears, and this is what was predicted. So again, it's not perfect, but it's reasonable. And when you do the things in the other way, this is what you get. In the experiment, you stick with the five-quarter wave more than with in the calculations. The calculations give you that. But then you move into the three-quarter wave here. Then you still have some three-quarter wave here, a stable region, and you start with this the three-quarter wave mode is here as well. So you observe that. And the point was, is it possible to actually jump to that point here? From, you see, you are just here, it oscillates. By triggering, is it possible to go here? And the answer is yes, it works. So this is the system, it's stable. And now we get into we have this mode, and then by so what you've seen here is that we blow on the flames, and they move to a different mode. It's a higher frequency mode, and so you have this switching taking place. The what is predicted by the diagram before, the fact that you shift from here down to here is actually what you get. All right. So this sort of things were continued, and we'll take a look at these by placing a duct on this side. So like that, you have a an upstream manifold, a flame, and a combustor. And in this case, you are like a generic combustion system with the three ingredients: the upstream, the flame, and the manifold. So it's time to stop for a quarter of an hour. So come back at 5:10.